Well, good evening, everybody, and thank you so much for being here tonight. We certainly appreciate it. This is Tuesday, June 12th, and we'll start this meeting by a roll call of your city council.
Councilors Anderson?
Here.
Entman?
Here.
Erpenbach?
Here.
Jameson?
Here.
Karski? Rolfing?
Here.
Staggers?
Present.
Aguilar?
Here.
Thank you. Appreciate that. We do have seven councilors in attendance tonight. We're very, very pleased to have Pastor Val Putnam from the Westminster Presbyterian Church here in Sioux Falls to lead us in prayer. After Pastor Val is done with the prayer, if you'd remain standing for our Pledge of Allegiance. Welcome, Pastor Val.
Thank you. Let us pray. Creator God, who created the beauty of this earth, and then you ask us to take care of it and the people therein. And there are public servants here tonight that have taken the lion's share of the load of caring for the people and creation, the land that you have given. May they do so with diligence, integrity, and unity. We thank you for their willingness to serve. We pray for each item on the docket, exciting or contentious. Making decisions of where monies are to be spent or opportunities before us. Lord, we pray that as each item is brought forward, your presence, your spirit, your peace will prevail in this hall. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. We'll now move on to tonight's consent agenda. Council, any changes or motions on the consent agenda?
Move to approve, Anderson.
Second, Jameson.
Councilor Anderson Jr. has made a motion to approve tonight's consent agenda. It was seconded by Councilor Jameson. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, a roll call vote, please.
Anderson?
Yes.
Entman?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
Thank you. That has passed 7-0. Thank you. We'll now move on to tonight's regular agenda. Any changes to tonight's agenda? Motions?
Move to approve.
Second, Anderson.
Thank you, Councilor Jameson. He's made a motion to approve tonight's regular agenda, seconded by Councilor Anderson Jr. If there is no further discussion, a roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entman?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
Thank you. That has also passed 7-0. Again, welcome to tonight's meeting. It's certainly great to have all of you here tonight. This is an opportunity for you to engage the City Council on any topic that may want to discuss. If it is an item that's later on in the agenda, we'd ask you to just wait until then. But if there's anybody who wants to come forward, please do so. Just state your name. And if you could keep your comments to 5 minutes or less, we would appreciate it. Welcome.
Good evening. My name is Cheryl Rath. Over the course of the last several years, much has been said about public-private partnerships. In September of 2009, Sioux Falls taxpayers entered into an agreement with South Dakota Junior Football. This is the 40-page document with the accompanying resolution. A resolution authorizing the mayor to enter into an agreement between the City of Sioux Falls, Sanford Health, and the South Dakota Junior Football Association regarding the construction of a sports complex. This agreement is entered into by and among Sanford Health, a South Dakota nonprofit, the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, a chartered municipality, and the South Dakota Junior Football Association. Whereas the city and junior football desire to construct a sports complex located in Northwest Sioux Falls, South Dakota, consisting of 12 grass fields, parking, and related site development to be located upon the real estate highlighted as the complex in Exhibit A attached hereto. Such sporting complex with an estimated construction cost of $5.7 million. Whereas the city has appropriated and made available $4.2 million to be applied towards the construction of Phase 1 as outlined in Section 9A of this agreement of the complex, leaving anticipated costs of $1.5 million to be raised and paid by junior football. Section 9A, on or before June 1st, 2011, the city will install the infrastructure for the complex, which shall include designing, detail grading, and seating 8 football fields, ADA walkways, public restroom, concession building, landscaping, and associated improvements. In connection with the construction of Phase 1 of the complex, the city will design and grade 4 additional football fields for future expansion. On or before June 1st, 2012, the city will construct and install approximately 800 parking spaces to serve the complex. The city agrees to maintain, at its sole cost and expense, the complex and the parking area in a manner materially consistent with the way other city-owned sports complexes are maintained. Junior football responsibilities. On or before August 1st, 2012, junior football shall install the football amenities for the complex, which shall include, without limitation, scoreboards, goalposts, seating, field lighting, and maintenance and storage building for junior football purposes. In connection herein, junior football shall use its best efforts to raise the entire balance of the unfunded cost to cover the cost of constructing said amenities. In the event junior football fails to install the amenities in good faith, then junior football shall be deemed to be in default pursuant to Section 14A of this agreement. I am here this evening to pose a question. Has South Dakota junior football met their $1.5 million obligation to Sioux Falls taxpayers? I personally believe that the Junior Football Association has a substantial distance to go to meet their commitment. In just a matter of days, junior football will take possession of the complex. Sioux Falls taxpayers expect and deserve to see the raw numbers. Monetary values need to be assigned to all in-kind donations, scoreboards, goalposts, seating, lighting, etc. The South Dakota Junior Football Association needs to make public their accounting of the $1.5 million. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you, Cheryl. Appreciate it. Is there anyone else who want to speak to the council tonight? Welcome, Mr. Stinga.
How are we doing tonight? A lot of topics to hit, but I wanted to, I was hoping Mark would be here. I wanted to compliment him on how 10th Street, East 10th Street's going. I think that we should look at how they're running East 10th, and maybe the city should be able to look at, they work until 8:30 at night. And I think that they should look at how many other projects can we work later on in the night to be able to get more done in the next day. I'm just trying to make things go a little bit faster, and I think you'll get more for your money. One thing I looked at is there was something said about new signs for Falls Park and whatnot. When you come down Cliff Avenue Hill, and I've been talking about this for the last 2-3 years, when you come down the hill, all we have is wood chips. Not a single plant. All there is weeds growing in it. Possibility to get some plants in there. Used to be trees going down each side. Every single one of them died, so what'd we do? We went in and cut them down and didn't replant them. Why? Let's make it look a little bit nicer, because that is the gateway to the Falls Park. Another thing, I did watch this when I wasn't able to be here. I watch 16 all the time. I don't think that politics should be brought into the city council. Anybody off the street, anybody that wants to run for city council should be able to run for city council without taking any kind of PAC money or special interest money. Because if it comes down to making it a politics, a lot of people aren't going to be able to run, and it's not right. About Walmart going up on, if I'm correct, 69th, or on the south side, I don't think it was right for the city council to be able to take jobs away from citizens of Sioux Falls just because they thought that there was too much traffic or whatnot. I think that between the city engineers and Walmart would have figured out how to make it easy to get in and easy to get out. We need jobs in Sioux Falls. There's a lot of people that are unemployed, not only needing part-time, but they need full-time work. Again, Greg, I looked at the same thing you did at the 4 o'clock meeting on the event center. The way I understood it, there was going to be one management team for all facilities. I worked for SMG for 7 years. They run a tight ship, and they do a great job on not only running the facility, but running the food. Do a great job. I found out when I took off here for giving money for the fireworks for the JCs. Grand Falls Casino has collected $9,500 already. So I think that's got to be taken into account on how much is going to be spent on fireworks to begin with. I think I'd have to ask the JCs on how much they pay for fireworks to begin with, how much money they have now, because I hate to see our money go up in smoke.
Thank you, Mr. Stinga. Thank you. Welcome.
Good evening. I'm Teresa Staley, and I have a challenge for you. Last year, Greg Jamieson and Michelle Erpenbach both held listening sessions with their constituents. And Michelle held hers at the library where it was. Greg, was yours was that televised by any chance? That was before the event center. But Michelle's was. And so that it was, to me, a fantastic gesture of saying, hey, we want to stay connected. We're going to do everything we can to break out of the little circle that we may become surrounded by, not by any fault of your own, but it having those meetings, publicizing it, inviting people to come in and share is fantastic. So I just would encourage you, if you're in the Southwest District, do that for those people. If you're at large, do it and invite the whole city to come in. Do it periodically, have it televised, and then just show the people that you really care about what the issues are that are affecting their lives. Thank you.
Thank you, Teresa. Folks, anybody else who want to engage the council tonight? Well, thank you very much. We appreciate it. We'll now move on to item number 9.
Second reading, an ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, amending Article 9, Chapter 38 of the revised ordinances of the city by defining and establishing procedures for special events.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council. Kelby Maris with Parks and Recreation. This ordinance before you tonight is is an update of Chapter 38 that will add some structure to special events that are held throughout the city, not only within the park system, but also on city streets. Sioux Falls hosts over 100 special events every year. Most of those events do happen in between the months of May and October, and of course the majority of those events then happen on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday toward the end of the work week as things start wrapping up for city employees. Many different city departments work on special events and help special event organizers work their way through the process. We have a group that gets together and meets with the event organizers and helps them through all of the permits that they're going to need for their event, depending on what they're going to do at their event. Some of the considerations that have been built into this ordinance are to define and classify special events. Basically, through our process, it's the nature of the event and not necessarily what the event is called that raises it to the level of a special event. When event organizers invite people to a public space, they are reserving the space for access or giving away things or selling food. That kind of thing raises it to a level of a special event, in which point other things have to happen, you know, not only within the park system, but as we're proposing here through ordinance. And Keith Allenstein does have some suggestions that may help clarify some of the suggested changes that may help clarify some of this in the definition section of this ordinance. This ordinance would also then require an insurance policy for special events that not only happen within the park system but on city streets as well. Currently, the Parks Department, we do require an insurance policy when an event rises to the level of a special event. We do require an insurance policy that names the city as additionally insured. This ordinance would also define reasons why events would not be allowed to be held, and also would define what reasons that an event may be shut down. Basically, just put some language in ordinance that would allow us to make sure that that the events are successful and that we are taking care of our public spaces. The ordinance also provides a timeline for event organizers to submit their application so that we make sure that as city staff and the event organizer, we've got enough time to work through their event to make sure that all their permits are in place, that they've thought of everything, and that the city support will be there at the day of their event. This ordinance would also allow the city to provide necessary equipment and then charge back for those services. Examples would include traffic control devices that the event organizers are responsible for. If for some reason they failed to provide that, but the city could then provide that for them for their event and then charge that back to the event organizer. Another thing would be dumpsters for a large special event that would require additional sanitation services that would go beyond what's available at the park. Event organizers are responsible for that. If that didn't happen the day of the event, we could then provide those dumpsters and then charge that service then back to them as well. And also this ordinance built in a, or defines a fee structure for special events. And special events then under 500 people, an application fee of $25. Under 2,500 people would be $100. Under 10,000 and all parades would be $250, and an event over 10,000 would be a $500 application fee. Now, this application fee is above and beyond all other necessary permits for whatever the event organizer is having within their event. If they're having fireworks, or they're selling food, or they're selling things in the park system, there's other independent ordinances that have fees attached to those items. Special events are, as we go through definition, are the things that are special events currently within within the park system and on city streets right now. It does not include private events, so weddings, corporate picnics, family reunions, birthday parties, those kind of things that now happen throughout the park system all the time. They're private events. The general public is not invited to that event, therefore it's not a special event. Also, press conferences. and somebody wants to hold a press conference within the park system on the steps at City Hall, that also is not a special event. It all depends on what they're doing within that event. Now, if they're going to have a speech on the front steps of City Hall, and they're going to put up a stage, and they're going to have a band, and they're going to give away food, that event is completely different than just giving a speech on the steps of City Hall. Proposed implementation for this ordinance would be for any event scheduled and held on January 1st, 2013 and after. The anticipated revenue that we anticipate for this fee structure within this ordinance is approximately $10,000, and it's split basically evenly between Parks and Recreation and the Police Department. And at this point, I'll have Keith address some of those suggested changes to the definition section.
Thanks, Kelby. Keith, welcome.
Thank you. Keith Allenstein, Assistant City Attorney. We would ask that there be an amendment or a few amendments to the definitional portion of this ordinance, one to address concern that Councillor Staggers brought up at the informational regarding political rallies or speeches, and also then just to clarify some language and to make sure our ordinance is as constitutional as we can make it. Just to summarize, we would ask that the definition of assembly remove the language outdoor wedding and church service, so that we're not regulating content. Again, we're trying to regulate the overall event as to what's going on and not what it specifically is involving. We would also ask that the entire section, which was added in 2003, regarding the downtown loop area, which begins in the downtown loop area and ends with subsection 2 there, which basically sets different rules for the number of persons which is considered an assembly, sets that number at 10 for the downtown loop area. We'd ask that that be stricken because we have concerns that that may not be constitutional under current case law. Additionally, as to the definition of parade, we would ask that the language where it talks about a motorcade consisting of, we would ask that the language 25 or more be added in there. Again, for constitutional reasons, there are cases out there that suggest that if you do not have a number in there, it may be not narrowly tailored and could be unconstitutional. Again, that same definition or that same inclusion of 25 or more persons, animals, or vehicles, or a combination thereof, open to the general public, we would ask that be added to the definition of special event so that we're not, again, talking about groups as small as 10 or fewer people, even than that. Additionally, we would ask that the special event, as it currently stands before you after first reading, it seems to suggest that it's mandatory, the list of examples underneath there. We'd like to make that more permissive and suggestive of the types of events that we're talking about here. And so we would ask that you add the word or replace the word shall with may, and then add the following language to subsection C of the special event definition, which would include the words by the way of sound amplification to the word music. We would ask that under subsection I, again, this was to address Councillor Staggers' concerns, remove political rallies or speeches and replace that with any activity involving the sale of merchandise, food, or alcohol. We would also ask them to add a subsection, a different subsection J, to make it a special event, which can include any activity making use of structures not already present on the public space, such as stages, booths, canopies, awnings, risers, bleachers, fences, partitions, stands, or similar constructions. That would be to address, regardless of the event, whether it's a political rally or anything, if you're bringing in bleachers and doing all that kind of preparation, that it could rise to the level of a special event. And then we would ask them that the former subsection J then would be moved to subsection K. So those are the things that we're asking that we think will further clarify what a special event is, and address some of the concerns that both Councillor Staglers brought up at information last week and some constitutional concerns that we researched and came across recently.
Keith and Kelby, thank you very much. This is a second reading, so the public, you have an opportunity to engage the council on this topic if you'd like. Is there anyone who wanted to speak to the council on this topic?
Mr. Mayor, before you do that, could I ask, Keith, could you put those amendments on the overhead so that folks could read those? We did. I would apologize to the council that we kind of had a misstep here and that we didn't get this printed. Councillor Intiman is prepared to make those amendments, but let's have the wording available so they can be on the overhead and then put on our screens too, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Sir, welcome.
Yes, good evening, Mr. Mayor, councillors. My name is Sean Clary with the representative of the Sioux Falls Irish Club, and we sponsor the Irish Fair every year. First of all, let me tell you that the Park District and the rest of the city services are absolute gems in our cooperation with us as we put together different festivals for the city. Kelby's folks are great. But I would be remiss just to make a few suggestions to the council for consideration. There are numerous volunteer-only driven nonprofit organizations that try to put on events throughout the city of Sioux Falls that we believe help the quality of life of Sioux Falls. Festival Cultures, Cinco de Mayo, Irish Fair, German Fest, numerous more that go on. We get all of our funding from fundraising. We hit up businesses. We go out and do this. They're all free. All these events are free for the folks to come. We sell nothing besides beverages to help pay for the bands to come and to, you know, have excitement for our city and have events to do every weekend so our folks are coming. I would also suggest perhaps that the people that we do bring in from not only in town but also out of town will make up for any tax dollars that could be shared throughout the city services, because quite honestly, you know, a few years ago the electrical requirements changed, so that started costing us more money. Now we have some more fees. Pretty soon the appetite may go sour, that the volunteer groups may just say, you know what, it's just too difficult to do, and now we have a summer where there's no events. I hope to say that never comes, but just wanted to let you know, though, the groups are great. Kelby's group is fantastic. The officers that are on duty with us, they do a great job. They jump when we ask them to, and they really do it. But I just ask you to consider, it's not a lot of money. Sure, we can pull it together, but is it just another fee and another event that has to have more collaboration with fundraisers? So thank you.
Thank you, Sean. Anybody else who wanted to speak to the council? Well, very good. Council, any comments or motions on this? Yes, Councillor Intiman.
Mr. Mayor, as a lot of people know, we do put on, or I do put on, a fairly significant event downtown in Hot Harley Nights. The services, again, that the city provide are absolutely fantastic. The logistics that go into putting on a huge major event like this are very significant, and a lot of people, other than those of us that put those on, really are not familiar with what is entailed in doing such a thing. And at the end of the day, the best thing about it is that we're preparing, we try to put on an event that is extremely safe for the people that attend, and at the same time, they're free to the public in the parks, and I think that that's what's key. The fee structure that is being proposed, I think, is within reason. They did involve a number of, Kelby and his team did involve a number of us in the events business, so to speak, when they were discussing these fees and the fee structures, and we feel very comfortable with the fees that are, with the proposed fees that they have made. There are some changes that Keith did allude to that we do need to make, and we'll be prepared to make that respective proposal amendment.
Very good. Councillor Intiman, did you want to read those into the record now?
No.
Okay.
It's an amendment.
Councillor Anderson, I'm sorry?
Not yet.
Councillor Anderson, Jr.?
Yeah, could I get Director Kearney or us to come up and reply to the reason for these fees, you know, what would, with the nonprofits and everything, and the reason why we do charge these fees?
Well, I think one of the things that Kelby's alluded to in his previous presentations is that obviously we get lots of requests for these special events. And I think initially the purpose of it is that there's buy-in from those organizations that are taking the time to fill out the application. Because the other thing I think Kelby's alluded to is that we'll get into the process of preparing for these special events and working through these events, only to find that really it's not a suitable event for a park. And maybe it's a better location on a, you know, we refer a lot of different groups to Wild Water West. We refer people to Great Bear, different venues other than our park system itself. And so by having the application fee, I think it's just a nice way to make sure that the folks are committed to doing these events. Because quite frankly, the current process is very easy to actually put on an event in our city, and we're trying to be very accommodating. Certainly that's one of the reasons.
And how about like for cleanup, security, those type of things to help these events happen in our parks and on our city streets?
Yeah, you know, the fee that we would plan to charge by no means comes close to being able to accommodate the amount of time and effort that our staff have in accommodating these events. You know, that would certainly put the, if we charged as much as it would take for us to support the events, obviously it would make it very difficult for people to be able to have special events. And so really it's just administrative time, administrative fee more so than it is anything.
Thank you.
Well, Councilor Enneman, would you be willing to make a motion?
Mr. Mayor, I
or
would
Councilor
move,
Rippenbach?
I would move approval.
Second.
Councilor Rippenbach's made a motion to approve this item, and it was seconded by Councilor Enteman. Is there any discussion?
Mr. Mayor.
Councilor Enneman.
I'd like to read the amended, the proposed amendment, if I might.
Thank you.
And Keith, as I go down, if you could page down, I'd appreciate it. I'm going to read the whole section 38-133, the definition sections. The following words, terms, and phrases, when used in this article, shall have the meanings ascribed to them in this section, except where the context clearly indicates a different meaning. Assembly means any block party. We are removing the outdoor wedding and church service language here that was going to be added to the present ordinance. A demonstration, rally, gathering, or group of 25 or more persons, animals or vehicles, or a combination thereof, having a common purpose, design, or goal upon any public street, sidewalk, alley, or other public place, which assembly substantially inhibits the usual flow of pedestrians or vehicular travel, or which occupies any public space. This section is going to be crossed out, other than a parade. That will be crossed out. Added will be, but does not arise to the definition of a special event. The next section will be stricken. In the downtown loop area, assembly means any block party, demonstration, rally, gathering, or group of 10 or more persons, animals, or vehicles, or a combination thereof, having a common purpose, design, or goal upon any public street, sidewalk, alley, or other public place, which assembly substantially inhibits the usual flow of pedestrians or vehicular travel, or which occupies any public area other than a parade or public park. The next sentence will be stricken also. Downtown loop area, for purposes of this article, means, next section, number one, is stricken. The central business district, which is that area of the city bounded by the west side of Minnesota Avenue to 4th Street to Big Sioux River to 2nd Avenue to 14th Street to Minnesota Avenue. Section two, subsection two will also be stricken, and it reads, the area bordered by the west side of Minnesota Avenue to Menlo Avenue between 10th Street and 11th Street inclusive. A parade means any scheduled walk, demonstration, procession, motorcade consisting of, this is an addition, 25 or more persons, animals, or vehicles, or a combination thereof, having a common purpose, design, designation, or goal upon any public place which does not comply with normal and usual traffic regulations and controls. A special event shall mean any of the following activities, and this is an addition, involving 25 or more persons, animals, or vehicles, or combination thereof, open to the general public, taking place on public space that involves a temporary and exclusive use of public space. This is an addition involving, we are going to strike the word or, a substantial deviation from current legal land use or legal non-conforming use, and this is an addition may strike shall include but not limited to A, amusements or carnivals, B, entertainment, C, music, this is an addition, by way of sound amplification, D, dancing, E, dramatic or theatrical productions, F, festivals, G, parades, H, runs, walks, triathlons, and bicycle races or rides that will not comply with the normal or usual traffic regulations or controls or are likely to impede, obstruct, impair, or interfere with free flow of traffic. This next section, I, is an addition. Any activity involving the sale of merchandise, food, or alcohol, we will strike political rallies or speeches. Subsection J, any activity, this is an addition, any activity making use of structures not already present on the public space, such as stages, booths, canopies, awnings, risers, bleachers, fences, partitions, stands, or similar constructions. And K, any activity taking place on public space, which may require for its successful execution city services to a degree significantly over and above the routinely planned, provided under ordinary circumstances, as determined by the Special Events Committee.
I will second that motion.
There has been a motion to amend item number 9 by Councilor Entenmann. Those items were read, and then they were seconded by Councilor Erpenbach. By the way, Councilor, very good job. Thank you. Is there any discussion on the amendment to the main motion? Councilor Staggers.
Yes, I'm going to be voting for these various amendments. It sounds like we have a lot of good changes made. However, after I vote on the amendment, and I'm going to assume it's probably going to pass, I'm going to offer to defer this vote until June 19th. And the reason for that is just to have a little bit more time to look at all the amendments that were added. So.
Any other discussion on the amendment? Very good. Let's have a vote on the amendment, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entenmann?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. We now have an amended motion. Yes, Councilor Staggers?
Yes. I guess at this time I would move to defer the vote on this until June 19th.
There has been a motion to defer the next vote on this until June 19th. Is there a second?
Second, Anderson.
A second by Councilor Anderson, Jr. Any discussion? Councilor Staggers?
No, I think it's going to provide us enough time to take a look at the amendments. And like I said, it looks like we have a lot of good changes made.
Very good. Any other discussion? Councilor Rolfing?
Yeah, I would. I think I would agree with Councilor Staggers on this one. This has come in, and it's not going to hurt anything for us to look at it for one more week and just so we can get it viewed all in one piece.
Very good. There has been a motion to defer this item until, I think it was June
19th.
19th. Thank you, Councilor Staggers. If there is no further discussion, a roll call vote on that motion.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entenmann?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. Item number 10.
Second reading, an ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, providing supplemental appropriations, $4,032,000.
Tracy, welcome.
Good evening. Tracy Turback with the Finance Office. This ordinance would supplement the 2012 budget and provide funding for quite a wide variety of projects involving four city departments, those departments being the library, facilities management, parks and recreation, and public works. You did hear mention last week of a proposed amendment that would fold in some private funding from the Zoo Society for that project, so I would hope you would consider that amendment tonight as well. You did receive an overview of each of these projects a week ago, but if you do still have questions, I believe we have representatives from all those departments here, so if there are additional questions yet tonight, we should be able to answer those. Thank you.
Director Turback, thank you. Folks, this is, again, it's a second reading, so if there's anybody who wanted to speak to the council before they had an opportunity, please come forward. Welcome, Mr. Stenga.
Um, got a few questions on the water feature that was never brought up at the city council meeting. Who pays for the electric bill to run the pump? Who cleans the filters for the pump? Who has the liability of the water feature? And how much is that going to cost? It says that it's going to be chlorinated. Normally, when it's chlorinated, you got to check the chlorine a few times a day. Who's going to do the maintenance? Is that free, or do we pay for that? The monitoring of this water feature. What happens if there's horseplay? Who are we going to have to watch this water feature? Are we going to just let people just go ahead and do what they want to do? Because we got to have the liability of this water feature. The money came from Public Works. The money should stay in Public Works. One thing as a taxpayer, and there's many of them out here, we deserve tip-top roads in this town. The secondary roads are poor. We're doing great on the main roads. 41st Street, Minnesota, Cliff Avenue is being done, 10th Street's being done. The main roads look good, but the secondary roads are just falling apart. If I was Mark Cotter, I would tell you guys to leave your hands off my money. I'm the one that made the money. I'm the one that saved everybody. This money's mine. First thing that's going to happen when we come in July, we're going to want more money for, if it's correct, it's the Parks Department, because we got to have somebody look at this facility. We got to find out how much electricity this pump is going to run. Nobody has come out and said that. But yet you're going to watch your water rates, your electrical rates, your trash. Everything is going to go up. I wonder why. Public Works is where this money should stay, because we got a lot of road projects out here. We had two companies from the north side of town come in probably about 2-3 months ago that said if the city would work on some roads up at the north end, maybe more businesses would move to the north end. I agree with them. I travel them roads. They're pathetic. Gravel, sometimes it's maybe a 2-lane road where you can just drive your car through, and you're lucky if it's raining, you don't get stuck. It's time that the city starts to realize that our roads are falling apart, and we need to do something, and it's drastic. You ever went outside after 9 o'clock at night? The mosquitoes would take you away. Now, I don't know if they spray for mosquitoes anymore in the neighborhoods. I've never seen anybody this year, and I'm lucky if I've seen somebody last year. I just think that we should do something for everybody in the city. When you go outside this building and you talk to people about what's going on, everybody asks me, how much money do we have to put downtown as a community? How many more projects do we have to spend our money on? That's my question today. How much more money do we have to spend downtown as a community? Because I always thought downtown ran around Sioux Falls. It's not Sioux Falls that runs around downtown. And I would like to see, and I have talked to Kenny about this, where we go into neighborhoods that need repair and maybe come up with some kind of TIF money so people can fix up their houses, be able to maybe add on an addition, be able to put siding on their house. Because a lot of people can't afford the taxes, because every time you do something to your house, the city's over there and they want to add taxes to your property. I haven't seen our tax rates go down yet. But boy, I'm praying. Thank you.
Mr. Dinger, thank you. Is there anybody else who wanted to talk on this item before we go to the council? Well, very good. Council, it is in your hands. Item number 10. Any motions or comments? Yes, Councillor Jameson.
I'd like to add that I think what I'll refer to as Citizen Stanga brought up on the operating expense for the water feature. Is there a way to give us a number on that? Anybody consider the oversight issue? Does it need oversight like a pool? I think those are just fair questions, and I would look for an answer.
Yeah, there certainly are fair questions, and we do have some experience with this over at Pioneer Park. We currently have a spray ground in that park location on the north side of Sioux Falls. And yeah, it does take some monitoring. It will have to be monitored, much like our other fountains have to be monitored along Phillips Avenue. And so it will be chlorinated, it will be filtered, and all the water will be recirculated within the system. So it's much like a pool operation, but a much smaller volume of water. You're not talking about massive amounts of water. There's a small tank underneath that would provide the supply water, because you're just talking about jets of water, not obviously large volumes. So there will be some operational costs. I can't tell you exactly what that is, but I certainly could pull that together for you if you wanted to. But it's not going to be a significant amount of money compared to a wading pool or some other aquatic facility that we have in the rest of the park system.
If I could, just to follow up, I think I had forgotten completely about the operating expense involved in a water feature like that. Anytime we do a capital improvement plan, we always consider, well, what would be the ongoing operating expense? I'd completely forgot about it. I'm glad to hear that you don't feel it's a significant amount or anything to worry about. You know, the I just can't believe I forgot it. Good.
And Don, the responsibility for maintaining the water feature along with the expense is the city's.
That's correct.
Very good. Thank you. Yeah. Councilor Urbanbach.
Thank you. Maybe you can answer this, maybe you can't. There's a pile of rocks that has water flowing over it down by the diner on Phillips Avenue. Is that park owned, operated, or is that downtown Sioux Falls?
I'm not sure about the actual ownership of the asset, what department that lies in, but we certainly do maintain it.
We do. The city does maintain that as well. So right. Chlorine.
It's a different system. It's hand fed, but we do maintain it on a daily basis.
And do we have someone down there monitoring if kids step into that water?
No.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Anderson Jr.
Don, just to continue on the River Greenway area, the steps down to the river and this splash park were both alternatives, correct? So they weren't in the original design for the River Greenway in that area?
Yeah, they were completely designed. The final design was completed on it. It was bid out. If we got good bids on it, we would be able to include it. And now we're talking about including it as part of our supplemental. So it was part of the entire bid package.
It was, but we weren't able to afford it, and that's why it's in the supplemental?
Yes. Yes, we didn't have enough in our current budget to accommodate the additional alternates.
Where are we sitting on the River Greenway as far as expenditures in what we had planned and what we are actually expending down there?
The final dollar amount for phase one is $5.4 million, and part of and the original budget for that project was at $5 million. And then total dollars spent between phase one and phase two is right at $8 million. And $2 million of that $8 million comes from the Big Sioux River Environmental Trust Fund.
And that was mostly for cleanup, though, correct? Wasn't that was that funds were supposed to be utilized for?
It was for, there's four different categories that it could be used for, and many elements of the Downtown River Greenway project were eligible expenditures as approved by the judge.
If we don't fund these alternatives, what's it going to look like down there? Is it just going to be a path in front of those two facilities that are being built down there?
It essentially would not have any water features associated with it, so it'd be more of just a concrete plaza. And then as far as the Step River Edge, instead of having concrete wall for that first 100 feet south of the 8th Street Bridge, it would just be a grass bank like we have on the north side of the bridge. This would allow us to build the Step River Edge and the river walls itself.
Thank you.
Yep.
Councilor Intiman.
Don, the original plan for the River Greenway, though, did include the fountain design and the step downs to the deal, correct?
That's
to the
correct.
River, correct? And it's my understanding in your last testimony that you gave us at the informational that we had, that if we do not put these in at this time, we probably will not be able to add them in the future because of the significant cost and demolition that we would have to do as a result of adding these on. So the cost would be a lot more significant for these if we were to add them in the future. Is that not right?
Yeah, and that's a great question. I asked the same question as we looked at those different alternates, but it's not practical to be able to add these later.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor Staggers.
Yes, Don, just to clarify, the total Greenway project, how many phases are there?
We haven't articulated, and actually, you know, obviously it depends on how much money you spend per phase, but the corridor that we anticipated, that we modeled and designed was from Falls Park to Fawick Park. And so we certainly think that it's probably a 10 to 20 year project for ultimate build out of that. But largely what we've been trying to do is do the improvements in concert with private redevelopment. And so we don't plan to go out and blindly build out, you know, the entire River Greenway on both sides of the river. What we're trying to do is time it with the CNA Surety building, the hotel building, so that we're working together with private redevelopment so that it makes sense.
So 10 to 20 years. Now, one time I asked a person involved in this project the anticipated total cost for the Greenway, and the number I recall was like $35 million. Is that about right?
Yeah, if you completely build it out, and it, obviously it depends on how fast you build it out, whether how many phases you do it in, but it certainly is a significant investment.
If I could just ask for your comment, I'm going to, I've been down on the Greenway, you know, with the ribbon cutting and so forth, and walking around and so forth, but the one thing that kind of surprised me is that there's not a whole lot of green. It looks like it's a concrete channel for the Big Sioux River through downtown Sioux Falls. And this seems to be just adding to that. I guess when I think of a Greenway, I think of shrubbery, I think of trees, I think of, you know, a quiet park setting, but it doesn't seem to really be a Greenway. Could you respond to my observation?
Sure. Well, I think the Greenway starts once you get to Fawick Park and head south through the park section of the River Greenway Master Plan. There were four different zones of the River Greenway Master Plan and the adopted plan that was approved in 2004 by the City Council. One was the downtown segment. One was the park section. Basically, it goes all the way over to Sotoma Park Fawick Park. I'll call it Fawick Park to Sotoma Park along the river. And then there was the west side, and then there was a confluence section. And so the improvements that we're making in the downtown section are reflective of that master plan.
And just one final question. The steps in front of the Hilton down into the water, are they truly steps? Are they going to be like the amphitheater in front of Chirapa Place?
We call them a step river edge because technically they're not steps.
So will it be similar to what's in front of Chirapa?
Yeah. Yeah, they will be. As far as the height of the riser, is that your question?
Well, we have kind of the amphitheater too and all that.
Yeah, there won't be an amphitheater on the piece in front of Hilton Garden Inn.
Okay.
Councilor Anderson Jr.
Question for Chad Hebe, please. Chad, one of the comments made by Citizen Stango was that these funds came from Public Works and should stay there. But actually, what happens, and I believe last week we even asked you if there was any other projects that could be funded. And I believe your statement was is that you guys were pretty much, your plate was full.
Well, I think that maybe Director Turback could comment. I was kind of confused by the statement that these funds came from Public Works.
I guess even if they did come from Public Works, what would happen if we didn't use these funds? Would they not go back into the general fund and then Public Works would be vying for those monies again?
Like I stated last week, we have taken all of our large projects for 2013
And because of the time it takes for the design, right-of-way acquisition, so on and so forth, we started those projects several months ago. And so our piece of the supplement tonight is to fund those other projects that we already had designed. So at this point, as late, I know we're just in the middle of the year, but we are getting into that point in the construction season where we can't start any more projects. The design phase just takes too long, and we're going to run out of time to build anything yet this year that hasn't already started with design.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Director Turbak, before I go to Councilor Entman, would you please explain briefly where the $4 million that the council is working on, where did that money come from?
The majority of that money came from revenues from our second penny sales tax coming in higher than anticipated in the budget.
Councilor Entman.
Okay. Don, I got one other question here for you. Councilor Stagers brought up the fact that there's a lot of concrete downtown in this area, and you alluded, you know, to the park continuing south, the true greenway. Of course, being a lifelong citizen, I'm very familiar with the ups and downs of the Sioux River, its high point as well as it virtually being dry. The design of our greenway area through the downtown, I'm assuming, and correct me if I'm wrong, that partially it was designed to mitigate the potential possible high water that we would have, which ultimately means then that we are able to develop in a better way the East Bank area. Is that part of the planning process that was involved with this with the Greenway plan?
Yeah, most definitely. I mean, I think there's nobody would argue that the cost to construct these improvements are expensive, but they are right along the River Greenway, and they're right along the Big Sioux River, which fluctuates greatly with flows coming out of Skunk Creek. And so it's designed to withstand the rise and fall of the Big Sioux River. And so if you're going to construct improvements, that's why we needed those river walls. It's also actually designed if the water comes over the top of those walls that the improvements will be fine as well. And so we're used to having the Big Sioux River flood. It does every year to some extent, and we're used to cleaning up after it too. But the beauty of it is that it gets people down to the water. It allows those improvements to be made in a manner that's complementary to what private development is doing immediately adjacent to the public property. And so yeah, it's all. There's a lot of factors that go into why we're building what we're building in those locations.
Thank you, Council. There's been very good dialogue up to this point, and I would expect it will continue. Would anybody want to start by offering a motion to move this forward?
Mr. Mayor,
Councilor,
I move approval. Aguilar.
Second, Rolfing.
Councilor Aguilar has made a motion to approve item number 10. It was seconded by Councilor Rolfing. Yes, Councilor Buck.
Mr. Mayor, I need to make a motion to amend. I'm going to amend the main motion to increase the supplemental appropriation for Parks and Recreation Sales and Use Tax Fund by $342,000. I would speak to that.
Second, Entman.
There has been a motion to amend this item by Councilor Urbanbach. It was seconded by Councilor Entman. Councilor Urbanbach?
Just a reminder that this is an additional $342,000 that would actually come from private donations through the zoo. It's that matching agreement that was left out of the wording of the original ordinance.
There has been a motion to amend, Council. If there's no further discussion on this, if we could have a roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entman?
Yes.
Urbanbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. So we now have an amended motion. Councilor Staggers.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to propose an amendment to delete the water feature and steps to the water. I move to amend paragraph 2, Parks and Recreation line, change $1,362,000 to $637,000. And street line change $1,480,000 to $2,205,000.
Very good, Councillor. Is there a second? That amendment dies for lack of a second. We'll now continue the discussion on the amended motion. Any further discussion? Hearing none, a roll call vote, please.
Mr. Mayor, can I make a comment?
Sure, Councilor Staggers.
Unfortunately, I'm going to have to vote against this ordinance. And the reason I'm voting against this ordinance is because we're going to be having the water feature and also the steps down to the water. Many people have expressed to me they feel this is an example of extravagant spending of taxpayer money, and it's wasteful. As already noted in our discussion, the steps to the water and the water feature were initially deleted. Now they're simply add-ons. And that's a clear indication that these are not really needed. These are simply wants. That's it. People have told me that the best water feature in the area is not going to be the water feature in front of the Hilton Hotel. No, the best water feature is just a few blocks to the north, and that's, of course, the falls, the Big Sioux River. That's the water feature that we want to attract everybody to see. This water feature that's being proposed to, we'd spend around $430,000, it's not even unique. I mean, I've been in other cities across the United States and have seen similar water features. I mean, they've been around for a long time. So we're not getting anything particularly unique at all. Since this water feature is going to be directly in front of the Hilton Hotel, it might be more appropriate for the Hilton Hotel to pay for this water feature. Finally, let me mention that the $725,000 that would have been saved with my amendment by not having the water feature and also the steps to the water would have been directed towards streets and the purchase of right-of-way. Now, having said the reason why I'm going to be voting against this, let me mention there are many other good projects here. But, you know, sometimes you have to send a message. And that's what my vote is doing here. It's sending a message that we've got to stop some of this extravagant and wasteful spending.
Councilor Shagers, thank you. Is there any further dialogue? Yes, Councilor Jamieson.
You know, this has been a long process and a lot of meetings to discuss how we were going to allocate this $4 million. And I think certainly Councilor Staggers would have benefited from some of those previous discussions. But we've all suffered through trying to figure out what's best for this for this money. You know, by at first glance, I wanted to spend it all on roads. Could have easily gotten me with that. It just said $4 million to roads. But, you know, listening through the discussions and listening to the community on other needs that were needed, you know, I've supported the River Greenway project from the beginning because I think it's a great asset for our city. It's a great tool for our community. And I just don't quite buy the argument that these are extravagant expenditures. They're just necessary. We can have a plain river bike path along the Greenway, or we can have something special. We're on the verge of making this special. This is only a part of what we're discussing tonight. You know, it is still about $1 million of spending on the Greenway project. I just have to express the support for it, even though I could have been bought on roads a long time ago. I think that there's other pieces of this plan that are coming together as well for the zoo and other road projects. So I'm supportive of this project or this proposal as amended. I think it's a wide variety of projects that are getting funded and things that are getting done for our city. And I guess I think we'll have a 7-to-1 vote as it may occur, but I just would be remiss if we didn't kind of set the stage a little better that the River Greenway is a huge investment for us, no doubt about it. And it's going to be expensive, but it is worth it. Long term, it is worth it.
Councilor Jamieson, thank you. If we could have a roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Intamin?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jamieson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
No.
Aguilar?
Yes.
That has passed 6-1. Item 11.
Second reading, an ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, amending chapters 11 and 42 of the revised ordinances of the city by changing the enforcement agency from nuisance visitation from Parks and Recreation to Planning and Building Services.
Kevin, welcome.
Good evening. Kevin Smith with Planning and Building Services. As has been mentioned at a recent informational meeting and at first reading, the main purpose of this ordinance modification is to complete the transfer of responsibility for the nuisance vegetation program from Parks and Recreation to Planning and Building Services. It also includes some clarification on the forestry end, which I believe Dwayne Stahl has already briefed you on, as well as brief modifications or minor modifications regarding nuisance vegetation, such as maintenance along rural section roads, and also how we're going to handle undeveloped properties. And by undeveloped, I don't mean individual lots in the central part of town. I mean large areas of unplatted lands that have been annexed but just haven't been constructed yet, constructed upon. This
Kevin,
has been, I'm sorry, I'm this sorry. Has also been presented to the Property Maintenance Board of Appeals. They manage the property maintenance standards for us. Also the Park Board and the Home Builders Association, and we have received no negative comments from any of those groups.
Kevin, thank you. Is there anyone in the audience who wanted to speak to this item? Very good. Council, any comments?
Move for approval, Anderson.
Second, Erpenbach.
Councilor Anderson Jr. has made a motion to approve this item, seconded by Councilor Erpenbach. If there's no further discussion, a roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Intamin?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 12.
First reading, an ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, amending Chapter 10 and 40 of the revised ordinances of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, by amending on-street bicycle ordinances.
Welcome, Sam.
Good evening, Mayor, Council. Sam Trebilcock, City of Sioux Falls Planning Office. This is first reading. You heard this afternoon at informational a good deal about the on-street bicycle ordinances, but quickly again, what we're trying to do is update, modernize, clarify on-street bicycle ordinances that have not been updated for quite some time. Our bicycle committee took a look at it and said, you know, as part of our ability to try to go out there and educate the public, the police, and everybody else at city about methods to share the road, motorist and bicyclists, that it's important that we move forward with these. So with this, it would be a catalyst for education. So that's what we're looking for.
Sam, thank you very much. Folks, this is a first reading, so we'll leave this in the council's hands tonight. Any questions or comments, Council? Councilor Jameson?
We had a shortened session this morning or this afternoon with the information. We had a lot of topics to cover. I just had a couple pieces that I wanted to ask about. A concern I have is that some of these changes almost empower the bicyclist to maintain or have ownership of the road and or right-of-way on the road. And I'm concerned that the people on the bikes will actually assume that they can now compete with a vehicle, a car, and may actually not give the way to the vehicle, saying they're going to hold their spot because they have a right to it, only to find themselves on the losing end of a confrontation with a motorized vehicle. Have you considered that aspect of this whole approach, that you're actually empowering bicyclists, and that I know you want to educate everybody on this topic, and I applaud that, but that's one of the concerns I have. Did you have that?
Yeah, we did talk about that, and I think it does empower. Right now, I don't think a lot of the motorists understand that there is a right for the vehicle to, or for the bicycle to be there and to have a certain spot. I don't think it's, when we discuss those kind of things, that it's going to be a concern that typically or hardly at all that you're going to have a bike that's going to take a spot and move so far over that it's going to be impossible to pass. What we're trying to do, again, is when, and the bicyclists, I think, would be the first to admit, you know, I'm going to stay over. I want them to pass when it's available. But, and a lot of bicyclists that teach this are going to tell you that when it isn't in the best interest for the vehicle to pass because they could clip them and put them into the curb, that's the time in which we want to educate the public. That's when you don't want to pass, when there's a parked car there or things like that. That's the times that we're trying to educate the public. You know, the bicycle is going to need to move over a little bit further to signal, maybe change a lane, because typically you'll probably have that on a four-lane roadway. There's another lane available to them. A lot of the lanes, the roadways that have available room, which is two lanes, usually have a parking lane too, and they can move over. So we didn't see it as an issue, and that's what other communities have found too.
And if I could as well, the I wrote it down, section 40-116.1, I think it is, that the intersection interchanges when, I'm not sure if that's the right phrase you used, but when there's a light that the bike does not set off the signal to change the light. You're now giving the rider authority to maneuver through an intersection that is telling them not to go. Wouldn't it be better just to say, enter at your own risk? I mean, instead you're giving them authority to do it. And so you're riding along and you just want to jump through the light. Like I've seen a lot of bicyclists do, they just treat it like it's just a recommendation and not a law. So I'm just concerned that we're actually inviting them to enter into a dangerous situation. That's just
something. And I'll answer that. Right now, again, as a vehicle being, a bicycle being a vehicle, the handicap that they're under as a bicycle is that a lot of times they are not able to change that signal at certain intersections. It doesn't sense them. If that happens for a motorized vehicle, there is a law already to handle that, where it says that the light does not operate properly, so they're able to move through for that purposes. But for the bicycle, they don't have that ability. So that's what we're trying to update there, based upon the Minnesota statute. So.
Thank you, Sam.
Councilor Heineman.
That I would have to agree with Councilor Jameson on that. By giving a bicycle a permission to go through a red light, okay? I've tried to address this with two-wheel motorcycles. We also do not trigger, in a lot of cases, light sensitivity. And it's my understanding in some states, and I think Minnesota is one of them, they permit a motorcyclist to go through a red light once he's given sufficient time. Mm-hmm. However, it's also my understanding in the state of South Dakota that that is not permitted. And with that in mind, I would suggest between now and the second reading, maybe we revisit that, because if that's a case for a motorized two-wheel vehicle, I'm not so sure that it's justification to allow a bicycle to go through the same light if we do not have that same ability to trigger that on a two-wheeled vehicle. And that includes motor scooters that are motorized, that are not licensed, by the way, do not have to have vehicle licenses. So in a case like that, I would suggest that maybe that is one section of this bill that we need to pull.
Yeah, and if I could answer just quickly, the reason we hadn't up to that point was just because typically we would have found that, even though I think you're right, that a motorcycle in many cases isn't going to trigger it, it would trigger it at a larger percentage of the time than a bicycle would. So we were looking at, we were noting that from our bike committee that was happening quite a bit.
Councilor Anderson,
certainly willing
Jr.
to look at that, though.
Councilor Anderson, Jr.
Sam, I'm going to chime in here real quick, agreeing with both counselors. And the other thing is, as a bicyclist, has the ability to dismount and use the crosswalk. So I guess I also would like you to take a look at that, and we're going to have to revisit that.
Sure.
Thank you.
Again, very good dialogue, Council. Would anybody want to set a date of hearing and second reading for Tuesday, June 19th at 7 p.m. for this item?
So move, Entman.
Second, Anderson.
Councilor Emmons made that motion, seconded by Councilor Anderson Jr. Is there any further discussion? Very good. A roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entman?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
Thank you. That has passed 7-0. Item 13.
First reading and ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, approving the release of the permanent utility easements in lots 10A and 11A, Block 9, Westwood Valley Addition to the City of Sioux Falls, Minnehaha County, South Dakota.
Good evening. Chad Heavey with the Engineering Division of Public Works. These permanent utility easements are located in the Westwood Valley Addition, which is near the Family Wellness Center at 32nd Street and Ellis Road. There are no utilities in these easements, and the city no longer needs the easements and supports their release.
Thank you, Chad. Team, would anybody like to set a date of hearing and second reading for Tuesday, July 10th at 7 p.m. for item 13?
So move, Entman.
Second, Anderson.
Councilor Emmons made that motion, seconded by Councilor Anderson Jr. If there's no further discussion, a roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entman?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
Thank you. That has passed 7-0. Item 14.
First reading and ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, approving the release of the permanent utility easements in lots 10A and 11A and lots 3, 4, and 18, Block 9, Westwood Valley Addition to the City of Sioux Falls, Minnehaha County, South Dakota.
Some of you may be sitting there thinking we just took action on that south easement, but I'll just clarify, this is in the same location. The issue with this is that these easements were granted on two separate plats by two separate property owners. Thus, it requires two separate ordinances to release those easements.
Chad, nice job. Thank you. Councilors, with that in mind, would anybody want to set a date of hearing and second reading for Tuesday, July 10th at 7 p.m. for this item?
So moved, Aguilar.
Second, Entman.
Councilor Aguilar has made that motion, seconded by Councilor Entman. If we could have a roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entman?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
Thank you. That has passed 7-0. Item 15.
A resolution amending the 2012-2016 capital program, $4,032,000.
Tracy, welcome.
Tracy Turback again. This resolution would amend the capital plan consistent with the supplemental appropriation ordinance that was presented earlier tonight, and like that supplement, the resolution here amending the capital plan would need to be amended consistent with the donation of funds for the zoo project.
Thank you, Tracy. Is there anyone in the audience who wanted to speak to this item? Very good. Council, any motions?
Move approval, Rolfing.
Second, Erpenbach.
Council Rolfing has made a motion to approve item 15, seconded by Council Erpenbach. Any further discussion on that?
Make the amendment.
Oh, Mr. Mayor.
Yes, thank you, Council Renneman.
I need to make the amendment as it reads here. A motion to amend the main motion to increase funding for the CIP number 193064, the Zoo Master Plan Improvements, by increasing the amount of funding for the zoo entrance monkey exhibit by $342,000, which will be funded by a donation from the zoo.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second, Erpenbach.
There is a second. Is there any discussion on that? Very good. A roll call vote, please, on the amendment.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entman?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. We now have an amended motion. Any further discussion? Very good. A roll, Councilor Staggers.
I guess I would just encourage my colleagues on the City Council, you can change your vote now and vote correctly on this. So,
thank you, Councilor Staggers. Thank you. If there is no further discussion, a roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entman?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
No.
Aguilar?
Yes.
That has passed 6-1. Item 16.
A resolution advising and giving consent to the appointment of members to certain citizen boards.
Thank you. Would you mind reading those for the public, please? Thank you.
Yes, sir. John Peterson, Board of Health, Falls Community Health Center Board. Craig Odens, Electrical Board of Appeals and Examiners. Tammy Bettenma, Orpheum Theater Advisory Board of Directors. Robert Fitzsimmons, Orpheum Theater Advisory Board of Directors. Nancy Savage, Public Parking Advisory Board. Eric Dykowski, Public Transit Advisory Board. Lee Vandenwall, Zoning Board of Adjustment. Chris Schultz, Zoning Board of Adjustments.
Thank you very much. Would anybody want to speak to this item? Council?
Move approval, Erpenbach.
Second, Entenmann.
Councilor Erpenbach's made a motion to approve item 16, seconded by Councilor Entenmann. If there is no further discussion, a roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entenmann?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. Item 17.
A resolution abating storm drainage fees and refunding storm drainage fees from 2010 through 2012 at parcel number 53604.
Good evening, Andy Berg with Engineering. Tonight, this first resolution is being brought back to the council. There is some confusion in our May meeting regarding a resolution to abate drainage fees and refund drainage fees for Mr. Marlon Hanton. The drainage fees to be refunded total $5,341.34. For the years 2010, 2011, and the first half of 2012. And he would also like those drainage fees abated for 2012.
Andy, thank you. Did anyone want to speak to this item in the audience? Council, any motions or comments? Councilor Rolfing.
Move approval, Rolfing.
Second, Anderson.
Councilor Rolfing's made a motion to approve this item. Seconded by Councilor Anderson Jr. Any discussion? A roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entenmann?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. Item 18.
A resolution refunding front foot assessments for street maintenance fees at parcel number 53604.
This resolution is also for Mr. Marlon Hanton. We came forward a couple months ago for Mr. Hanton to refund street frontage fees for his property. The ordinance allows for us to go back 4 years on that. We went back 4 years from current year when he had actually approached us the year before, so this is adding that fourth year on the original request. That amount to be refunded is $444.
Andy, thank you. Council, any motions?
Move to approve, Anderson.
Second, Entenmann.
Councilor Anderson Jr. has made a motion to approve this item, seconded by Councilor Entenmann. If there's no further discussion, a roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entenmann?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. Item 19.
A proposed resolution vacating the public right-of-way on alley from south right-of-way line of West 13th Street to north right-of-way line of West 14th Street and Block 2 Grigsby Addition.
Chad.
This unimproved right-of-way is the alley just west of Minnesota Avenue between 13th Street and 14th Street. The petition was initiated by Eric Willardson. A utility easement will be maintained. If vacated, the land will be used in the redevelopment of the entire block, and the petitioner will be present at the hearing to answer any questions you may have.
Chad, thank you. Council, would anybody want to set a hearing date for Tuesday, July 10th at 7 p.m. for this item?
So move, Anderson.
Second, Aguilar.
Anderson, Councilor Anderson Jr. has made that motion, seconded by Councilor Aguilar. There's no further discussion. A roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entenmann?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
Thank you. That is passed 7-0. Item 20.
A proposed resolution vacating the public right-of-way on West National Guard Drive from North Minnesota Avenue to 2,961.85 feet west as shown on attached exhibit.
This improved right-of-way is on the north end of the airport, west of Minnesota Avenue. The petition was initiated by Dan Letelier, the executive director of the Sioux Falls Regional Airport. A utility and access easement will be maintained. The right-of-way vacation will allow the street to be changed from a public street to a private street. This will allow greater flexibility for Maverick Air Center to transfer fuel from their fuel farm to the new West Side General Aviation Ramp. The petitioner will be present at the hearing to answer any questions. And I just want to reiterate, we have a right-of-way vacation policy that's based on state statute. One thing that we do have the flexibility that we generally determine whether we feel we need to have a neighborhood meeting to discuss the right-of-way vacation. So like with the alley in the previous one, we will not be having a public meeting because the alley is unimproved. So as we move forward with these, I'll just probably mention whether we plan on having a meeting or not. This one, we do not plan on having a neighborhood meeting.
Thank you, Chad. Councilor Sagers.
Yeah, Chad, you said this is going to be a private road. Is it going to be owned by the airport, or who's going to own it?
It will be. The city owns a little bit of land that fronts that road, and so typically when these right-of-ways get, the county determines who the land goes back to, but typically half the right-of-way goes back to the one side of the road, the half goes to the other. So the majority of this road will be owned by the airport. They will do all the maintenance, and they currently do all the snow removal. But when it gets time to, it needs to be repaved, it'll be the airport's responsibility.
Very good. Council, would anybody want to set a hearing date for Tuesday, July 10th at 7 p.m. for this item?
So move, Anderson.
Second, Rolfing.
Councilor Anderson Jr. has made a motion. It was seconded by Councilor Rolfing. If we could have a roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entman?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
Thank you. That is passed 7-0. Item 21.
A proposed resolution vacating the public right-of-way on North Lewis Avenue from North Lewis Avenue to East 50th Street North, as shown on Exhibit A.
This unimproved right-of-way is just north of the Benson Road and Lewis Avenue intersection. The petition was initiated by Randy Thompson. A utility easement will be maintained. If vacated, the land will be potentially used to redevelop the property. The petitioner will be present at the hearing to answer any questions you may have. The reason this land is there, when the decision was made to change the alignment of Lewis Avenue and curve it to the east, that the remnant is this little piece of unimproved right-of-way.
Chad, will there be a neighborhood meeting for this one?
No, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, Councilor Rolfing.
Chad, we've had a lot of discussion about traffic patterns and things up there. Is this going to hinder anything up there that way?
It currently is what you see now. It's nothing. It's not a road or anything.
But I mean, if they, as you develop that one, you know, we were talking about Jessica National and all that. That's not going to, because yeah, we're going to come in on 50th there.
Yeah, the road would be 50th and Jessica. We would never recommend this road be constructed.
Good job, Councilor Rolfing. Council, would anybody want to set a hearing date for Tuesday, July 10th at 7 p.m. for this item?
So move, Anderson.
Second, Entman.
Councilor Anderson Jr. has made that motion. Seconded by Councilor Entman. A roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entman?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
Thank you. 7-0. That motion is passed. Item 22.
A proposed resolution vacating the public right-of-way on alley adjacent to lots 1 through 7 and lots 16 through 22, Block 5, Tower Park Addition.
This unimproved right-of-way is just north and east of the intersection of East 6th Street and North Cleveland Avenue. The petition was initiated by David Gibbon. A utility easement will not be maintained. If vacated, the land will be used for residential lots. A neighborhood meeting will not be held, and the petitioner will be present at the hearing to answer any of your questions.
Thank you, Chad. Council, would anybody want to set a hearing date for Tuesday, July 10th at 7 p.m. for this item?
So moved, Aguilar.
Second, Jameson.
Councilor Anderson, Councilor Aguilar has made that motion. It was seconded by Councilor Jameson. If there's no further discussion, a roll call. Oh, I'm sorry, Councilor Anderson Jr.
I just have one question, Chad. Since we're not going to have a neighborhood meeting on the vacation, when that property develops, will there be a neighborhood meeting to discuss the development?
I think if it has to go through the zoning process, I would assume there will be a public meeting, but I can't say for sure.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Anderson Jr. If we could have a roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entman?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. Item 23.
A proposed resolution vacating the public right-of-way on East 4th Street from North Harrington Avenue to North Sherwood Avenue, except 12 feet for alley right-of-way.
This unimproved right-of-way is also north and east of the intersection of 6th and Cleveland. Now, the petition was submitted by David Gibbon. A utility easement will not be maintained. If vacated, the land is proposed to be used for residential lots again, and the petitioner will be present for any questions, and a public meeting will not be held.
Council, thank you. Would anybody want to set a hearing date for Tuesday, July 10th at 7 p.m. for this item?
So move, Anderson.
Second, Entman.
Councilor Anderson Jr. has made that motion, seconded by Councilor Entman. If we could have a roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Entman?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. Item 24.
A proposed resolution vacating the public right-of-way on North F Avenue from West Algonquin Street to West Blackhawk Street.
This right-of-way is improved and is south of the airport and west of Minnesota Avenue. The petition was initiated by Doug Berkland with Sayer Associates for Raven Industries. A utility easement will not be maintained. If vacated, the land will be used for future development by Raven. The petitioner will be present to answer any questions, and we will be having a neighborhood meeting for this petition.
Thank you, Chad. Council, with that in mind, would anybody want to set a hearing date for Tuesday, July 10th at 7 p.m. for this item?
So moved, Jameson.
Second, Entman.
Councilor Jameson's made that motion, seconded by Councilor Entman. Councilor Anderson Jr.
Chad, have we resolved any of the problems with vacating the street for businesses along Blackhawk?
Well, a little history. Andy, if you could go back a couple slides. Just to the northwest is H Avenue, and last year they submitted a petition to vacate both H and F. And what they ended up doing was vacating the north part of H Avenue. And then we asked them, since they weren't ready to develop till now, if they would withdraw the F Avenue. And when they did vacate H Avenue, there was some concerns by Daniels and Olson's and other properties that were adjacent to H. Now, I haven't had any direct contact with anybody regarding this, but we usually have the neighborhood meeting once the council sets the date of hearing so that we can communicate to them of when the date of hearing has actually been set. And if there are any comments, and I feel it's appropriate, I will let you know prior to the hearing date.
Councilor Anderson Jr.
I guess I just go back to, I believe this was about 2 years ago when Ravens first came to us about this, and the businesses along Blackhawk were very concerned about being able to have their wares delivered to their businesses. And I think that is still a concern and something that we're going to have to really consider here, because now if we do vacate this street, those businesses right to the south are going to have their vehicles go a whole different route that could be a lot more difficult to get their wares to those businesses.
If I could, Mayor?
Please.
I will say, when we talked about both of these vacations at the neighborhood meeting last year, and we only had one comment regarding the vacation of F, and that has to do up at Industrial and Algonquin, where it has this, it was kind of a difficult turning movement for trucks because of a building, but the building's no longer there, but I will certainly bring it up at the neighborhood meeting.
And also, Chad, if I can request, if this goes to the second reading, that there's some examples on how those vehicles are going to be able to get to those businesses.
Certainly.
Thank you.
Good teamwork. Thank you. Council, would anybody want to set a hearing date for Tuesday, July 10th at 7 p.m. for this item?
So move, Anderson.
Second, Rolfing.
Councilor Anderson Jr. has made that motion, seconded by Councilor Rolfing. And if we could have a roll call. Oh, we already did? Oh, my gosh. Councilor Jameson, Councilor Henneman, my apologies. You've already made that motion. With that in mind, if we could have a roll call vote, please.
Councilors Anderson?
Yes.
Antiman?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Aguilar?
Yes.
Great job. Council, any new business items tonight? Would anybody mind setting a making a motion to adjourn?
So moved, Erpenbach.
Second, Anderson.
Councilor Erpenbach's made that motion, and it was seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. This motion, or this meeting is adjourned. Council, you certainly earned your money tonight in many, many ways. Thank you so much for representing our people. And for those of you in the audience who are still here at 8:40 p.m. at night, thank you. Make it a great night, Sioux Falls.